Member Union. Today we're celebrating Resurrection Sunday. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I submit to you on that vein that as blood-bought righteous Christians, we should celebrate Easter every day. Amen. Your eyelids flutter awake and your feet touch the ground. Thank God he kept us through the night. Amen. It's good to see you, family. Great to see you. I'm sure you're all on the email list and you've got the list of things we're praying for this Holy Week. Physical healing and better bodily stewardship, quick repentance and forgiveness in our homes, minds better focused on Christ, more frequent and bold gospel declarations, more tangible love one to another. Continue to pray for those things throughout the service today. I know we've been working on it all week. Won't belabor the points. I'd ask you, family, to pray. Pray for our community. And don't be deceived. We're at war. You can open the second or third page of Genesis and find that the serpent is deceitful. We're at war, family. With your Sunday best on, we're at war. In Proverbs, the writer, Proverbs 20, says, "The bread of deceit is sweet to a man, but afterwards his mouth shall be filled with gravel." Don't be deceived, saints. We're at war. Every purpose is established by counsel. With good advice, make war. Lord, we ask you today to cover this house, cover everyone that would call themselves by your name Christian, that they be blessed, excuse me, blessed, and carry out the Great Commission. When you call yourself Christian, there's no you don't have to wonder what your marching orders are in this war. We got our marching orders. They're right here, a book full. I submit to you, saints, that the opposite of this statement, the bread of deceit is sweet. Sometimes the truth is a bitter pill to swallow, but we need the truth. We need the truth. Lord, let us hear. Let our leadership speak the truth in and out of season. Lord, forgive us for not listening. We celebrate Resurrection Sunday today. He is risen. The stone was rolled back. Him that we sought is not in the tomb. He is risen. Lord, thank you for being risen. Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for yelling out, "Give us Barabbas," until I was hoarse. Lord, forgive me. There's nothing that I've done to make me worthy. It's what you've done, Lord. Lord, thank you for this opportunity. One more day to come to your house and pray. Lord, we ask that you would anoint our voices today. We've got family in town. We've got seasonal allergies in town. Let our voices lift up and be a sweet sound to you, Lord. We're here to praise your name, and we hope that you and pray that you hear it in that manner. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you for your written scripture. words to us. It seems that sometimes our culture thinks that Christians are meek and mild and don't want to stir up any trouble and sit in the sidelines. But my Bible says something different. This is the King James Version, may be different than something else, but in Matthew, our Lord says, "Think not that I come to send peace on earth. I came to send peace, not to send peace, but a sword." We're at war. We are at war. "I come to set a man at variance against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes shall be of his own household." Well, that's tough when that hits. That this war is not just in the street, not just in the media, but down to the end of the dining room table. Lord, give us strength. Give us strength to govern that lowest level of government, family. Lord, thank you. You know, that's my default. I thank God I'm not what I was. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to see another day. I deserve it. I knew the right answer. I could quote the Lord's Prayer from adolescence and still straight off look for that wide highway instead of the narrow road. Lord, forgive me. Thank you for bringing me back. Thank you for putting those speed bumps and those obstacles in the way to get back on the narrow road. Thank you for what we think is chance meetings of people that turn our life around. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Lord. You know, family, we're not out here alone. Well, we have a family. If our God is for us, who can be against us? In Ephesians, we have some instructions on how to prepare for the battle day in and day out. Be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you might be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. I read that again, the whole armor, not just the pieces you like, the ones that are comfortable. You got to put the whole thing on. Oh, Lord, thank you. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against spiritual wickedness in high places. We take on this armor so we can withstand in the evil day. Gird your loins with truth and have on the breastplate of righteousness. Your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Taking the shield of faith where you'll be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. It's all here. The Lord has provided us directions, saints. Take up the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Watching with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. for which I'm an ambassador in bonds, and therefore may I speak boldly. I know we all dress pretty, but stand up a minute, give praise to God. There's a war on. We cannot be sidelined Christians and wonder what happened. Lord, stand in and pray. Pray for your family, your church family, your blood family, your work family. Pray. Lord, I ask that each and every one in this church this morning that call themselves Christian get closer to you. Let us be closer. Give us understanding of your word, not just vain repetitions as hypocrites. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for these opportunities. Thank you for the word you sent to guide us. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you for every family here with the full quiver that brings their kids in to sing for us this morning. Oh, that is awesome. I'm excited about that. The stone was rolled away. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I'll say it again, Lord. Help lift our voices up that it might be sweet, sweet praise to your name, Lord. Your name is forever. Your name is holy. We're here for a short time. Let us use that time wisely. No better way to spend a day, a lifetime, than singing the praises of God, singing his holy name. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for letting us gather. Thank you for family to lean on. It's not happenstance, Lord. It's your plan to put us here today. You put us with these brothers and sisters to lean on, to help us through the storm, and help us through the peaceful days. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, hallelujah, church. Hallelujah, church. Is it not a glorious day? Is it not a wondrous day? Is this not the day that the Lord has made? And if you have no reason to be glad, rejoice in the fact that the Lord has allowed you to wake up on this morning. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Will we not enter his gates with thanksgiving in our hearts? Will we not enter into his courts with praise? Will we not say, this is the day that the Lord has made? Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad. Oh, saints, the Lord woke you up this morning. He put you in your right mind. You have the faculty of your limbs. He allowed you clothes on your body, food within yourself, and he brought you into his house to worship him, on this day that we celebrate his victory over hell, death, and the grave, this day where he went down and he rose and is forever seated at the right hand of the Father with all power in his hand, this is a day. This is a day. This is a day to celebrate. This is a day to rejoice. This is a day for thanksgiving. This is a day to say hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christ lives. Christ lives. Christ lives. Beloved, what are your problems in light of Christ risen? What are your struggles in light of Christ risen? What are your concerns and your doubts in light of Christ risen? Now that doesn't mean that our concerns and our struggles and our doubts don't matter. No, on the contrary, because Christ risen, the things you go through are not in vain. The Lord sees everything that you deal with. He sees every struggle. He sees every pain. And he is interceding on your behalf right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. So good morning, church. Oh, what a day to come to church today. What a day to stand and give praises to our King. What a day to shout wondrous things unto the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He who deserves it. He who is the only common denominator. And I would like to read for you, if I can, from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And Paul goes on to say, he says, now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection from the dead? But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is also in vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified that God raised him up, whom he have not raised. If so be it that the dead is not raised. For if the dead raise not, then is not Christ raised? And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, and you are yet stuck in your sins. Beloved, if Christ is not raised, every message, every sermon, every exhortation, every prayer from this pulpit has been a lie. If Christ is not be raised, we are still stuck in our sins on a road to hell. If Christ be not raised, every prayer is for naught, because we have been false witnesses unto our God. But now Christ is risen. But even now, Christ is risen. Buddha is dead, Christ is risen. Krishna is dead, Christ is risen. Muhammad is dead, Christ be risen. His tomb is empty. There is nobody. Where is he now? Seated at the right hand of the Father with all power in his hand. Where is he now? Seated at the right hand of the Father, overcome death, hell, and the grave. Where is our Lord, King of Kings reigning? Christ be risen, beloved. Christ be risen. Hallelujah, Christ be risen. Hallelujah, Christ be risen. But now, Christ is risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam, all died. You and me, everybody, all died. And so even in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterwards they that are Christ at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom of God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rules, all authority, all power, for he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. And here's the beautiful part. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. So even those who have died will rise again in Christ. Even those who struggle shall rise again as Christ. Just as Christ be risen, so shall we.
who are in Christ, who have been grafted into the family of God, who have placed our faith in Christ and the work when he said it is finished upon the cross, we shall rise. And hallelujah for it. And it's going to be a glorious day. So join in with our babies as they sing unto our King, that living he loved me, that dying he saved me, that buried he carried my sins far away. And it's going to be a glorious day when he returns. Amen.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. And what truly a glorious day it was. And the weight of what Christ did, it allowed us to do something we could not do for ourselves. For the word declares that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. And it goes on to list a list of sins, but basically what he's saying is your unrighteousness, my unrighteousness, prevents us from going into the kingdom of heaven. But then it says, but such were some of you, and but you were washed, you were sanctified, and you were justified in the Lord Jesus Christ. So because he has risen, again, because he has risen, because he died upon the cross, we are able to inherit the kingdom of God. The God who was all powerful, the God who holds the universe together, that same God cares enough about the hairs upon your head, even their number. That same God stepped down from glory. That same God wrapped up human flesh. That same God lived the perfect life and died. And he didn't stay dead, he rose. He didn't stay dead, he rose. He didn't stay dead, he rose. So it's not by your might, it's not by your power. It's not by how good you are. It's not by a penance that you pay. But it's by a belief in the all-powerful God who is seated upon a throne and the great provision that he has made for us. So we sing to this holy God, this thrice holy God, how powerful he is, how wonderful he is, and how we give glory and honor unto him.
Hallelujah. Our God has all power in his hand. We worship you, Jesus.
Oh, church. Okay, no music, just the beat, everybody. Here we go. The angels. Can you just... Can you just lift your hearts to the Holy One just for a moment? Your hands, if you are so inclined. Lord, we are undeserving of your mercy, undeserving of your grace. We acknowledge that there are no other gods but you, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the thrice holy God, the God who has revealed himself in three persons, but the one true and living God. And on this day, so many believers around the world set aside this time to be reminded that the Lord Jesus Christ did not stay in the grave, but he got up from the grave. And as Don said earlier, because the Lord got up, we're getting up. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, "Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, as he said." Come see the place where the Lord lay. Thank you, Lord, for getting up from the grave. Thank you for paying the penalty, the due and righteous penalty of our sin. The wrath of the Father was poured out upon the Son that one day we might be inheritors of the tree of life. We don't take that for granted today, Lord. We celebrate with thanksgiving in our hearts and on our lips what you have done. We don't deserve it, but you've counted us worthy and chosen us for salvation. Thank you today, Master. We worship you prayerfully in the beauty of holiness. We give your name honor because you deserve it. We're not ashamed to declare our love for you. We love you. Bless your holy and righteous name. Be thou exalted in our midst. Change our hearts to be in alignment with thy word. And in all these things today, receive honor, glory, and praise. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And all of the people of the Lord on a beautiful Resurrection Sunday, say it, amen,
amen,
amen, and amen. Go ahead and hug your neighbor. Choir, my goodness. Wow. You will always be oh yeah, oh yeah. Holy. You will always be. What's up, Josh?
Good.
I'm going to do my best, bro.
Father God, thank you for my brother right now. I pray for his voice, Father God. Through his voice, that he might deliver the word you will need to hear today. So in my name, Jesus, I pray.
Amen. 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 Holy. Yes, indeed. Holy forever. Let the angels cry, holy. Glory to God. Dee, good morning, sir.
Yes, sir.
Happy resurrection, man. You made it help me out today, bro.
Yes, sir.
Glory to God. All right, good morning. Good morning, good morning. Happy Easter, happy Resurrection Sunday. So glad to be with you today. Y'all looking good today too. Y'all took me back to my childhood today with all the Easter colors and praise God, so wonderful to see you. God has been so good to us. Amen. Deacon Martin already called out the seasonal allergies. Y'all pray for a brother this morning. But we're going to do the best that we can. Good morning, CRC. Good morning. Amen. One more hand clap for our Lord today. Thank you, Master. Amen. God has been so good, so kind. And I definitely feel better than I sound. And so we are grateful to have you here in the house today. And thankful for the mercies of God for one more year passing, one more opportunity to celebrate his resurrection. Of course, as the good deacon said earlier, we should be celebrating his resurrection. And indeed, we try to each and every Sunday. And so we're thankful for you all being here with us today. If you're visiting with us today, and this is your first time here at Calvary Reformation Church, we'd just like to say welcome. We're not going to make you stand up or say anything, but we would like to say welcome. And if you are so inclined to let us know that you're here on your way out the door today. There's some visitor cards back there that we often use just to try to stay in touch with you to see how we might serve you. If you're so inclined, please feel free to fill those out. I promise you, we won't spam you. We just want to let you know that we know that we're glad that you came and see if there's any follow-on ways that we could be a bit of a blessing to you. It's a wonderful season for us right now. Not only is it a resurrection season, but within 4 or 5 weeks or so, we'll be celebrating, Lord willing, our 27th church anniversary. Isn't that crazy? It's amazing. 27 years, hard to believe. And that week is just jammed with good stuff. On April the 18th, we're going back to the skating rink as a family. We hadn't been there in a while. If you got our email, you know that requires a registration, but we hope that you join us over at Greenbrier Skate as they throw on some Christian music for us and we skate around. And my prayer already is no broken bones, Lord, please. Just all wrists and ankles intact when we leave there in the name of Jesus. And then that upcoming Saturday, we're having a church picnic at a different park. I forget the name of it, but it's at a different park that we've gone to in the past. And then, of course, that upcoming Sunday, April the 21st, we'll be right here, Lord willing, preaching and celebrating 21 years. And also the highlight of that day is the ordination of 3 new elders. Amen. So we're excited about that. We certainly need the help. And you guys, you all deserve strong men leading you and praying for you. And we're grateful for these men. We're grateful for their wives and the faithfulness that they've displayed for year after year after year. And we're looking forward to that opportunity to see them set into such a wonderful office, and such an office that holds such, well, it's kind of heavy and a lot of responsibility, and they're helping us bear it. And so we're grateful for them. So that's all coming up. You already get into the Word of God today? All right, so I've been joking you that my notes have been too long. They still are. I just have the long ones up here, and y'all got the short ones out there. What can I say? We're going to do our best. Let's go back to the book of Hebrews this morning. I was debating whether or not to preach from a traditional resurrection text, but I thought we would just stay right where we are in the book of Hebrews, because the very next verse lent itself so well to today. And I hope that's okay. Hebrews chapter 3 this morning. Hebrews chapter 3. And we're going to read this morning from verses 7 through 11. Now, you might see folks standing. That's our tradition. When the Word of God is read, it's just a tradition. Feel free to stand with us if you'd like. Deacon Will's going to help me read this morning. He doesn't just do that when my voice is off. He does that, period. It's kind of going back to our roots there a little bit, but he's going to help us read. We're reading up here from the King James Version of the Bible, but we are not King James only by any stretch. We love LSB and CSB and other versions. We just tend to use it from the front. But Hebrews chapter 3, verse number 7 and down through verse 11. Whenever you're ready, Deacon Will.
Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts, as in the provocation, in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. Wherefore, I was grieved with that generation, mm-hmm. and said, they do always err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter.
Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith today, say that word with me, today.
Today.
So look at somebody and say, not tomorrow.
Not tomorrow.
So find somebody else and say, you don't even know if you're going to get tomorrow. Today, if you will hear his voice, there's a command in verse 8, harden not your hearts. The way that flows is that you have a role in the hardening of your heart. Harden not your hearts, as in the day of provocation. We'll briefly touch on that. In the day of the temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years, wherefore I was grieved with that generation, and said, they do always err in their hearts, and they have not known my ways. So I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. The book of Hebrews, chapter 3, verses 7 through 11, harden not your hearts. Harden not your hearts on a beautiful Resurrection Sunday. Let's pray together. Father, as always, when we come to the Holy Text, we are in critical and deep need of you. Left to ourselves, Lord, we often don't understand fully what's being communicated. Left to ourselves, our hearts often struggle with what is being communicated. And so I pray today, Master, that you would protect the thoughts and words of me, just a sinful servant saved by grace. I also pray, Lord, that you would soften the hearts of your people, that you would open their eyes and their ears. Perhaps even, Lord, if there's one here today who may not know you in the pardon of their sin, Lord, that you would do that which only you can do, which is in the midst of this time, show them their sin, cause them to flee to you for salvation. In all these things, Lord, we completely admit our utter need for you and completely admit our sinfulness. We pray that you would cleanse us of all of our wickedness and unrighteousness. We know you have in our salvation, but just our day-to-day mess that keeps us from understanding and obeying. Oh, Lord, we pray that you would do something different in us today. Cause us to hunger and thirst for you and for your righteousness. We love you and we thank you for coming, living, bleeding, dying, and rising again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please take your seats. Thank you once again. So many of you here, we're glad to have you today. Now, if you're visiting with us, there are a few of you here and glad that you're here. But if you are visiting with us, know, by the way, if you're looking for seats, there's some up in the front area rows. But if you are visiting with us, know that we, for the last several months now, I guess, been working our way through the book of Hebrews. This is a church that believes in something called expository preaching. That is to say, we want to figure out what the Holy Spirit put into the text, first to the original hearer and then for us through them. And we believe in most expositors, many expositors like to take scripture in big old chunks. And so we do some topical preaching, as most churches do at times, but the bulk of what we try to do is just take books or large swaths of scripture and just walk our way line by line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, so that we can kind of immerse ourselves in the context and get everything God will possibly give us out of the text. And through lots of prayer, we felt like Hebrews, because of its high Christology and because of the sacrifice that it calls for, and we may touch on that here today, we felt that it would be a good place for our church to spend how many ever months, maybe even a year or so in this text. And so we started in chapter 1, verse 1. We find ourselves now in this particular chapter. And so if there's anything that you see in those first few chapters that looks intriguing, we covered it the best we can, and you can find all that stuff on our website. But so far in Hebrews, we've seen, worked our way through, read our way through, preached our way through what to us seems like a very intentional apologetic or a defense of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done by the author of this book, which, you know, we just call him the author because, you know, there's people who attribute it to Paul and others, but it's enough in doubt to where we say just the author or the writer. And so the author, via the Holy Spirit, to convince and or encourage primarily Hebrew or Jewish believers, and some who were actually struggling with the faith as well, based on the context, to believe in and hold fast to Christ. Now, when we say an intentional apologetic, he starts right off in chapter 1 with the word God, theos in Greek, and says immediately that in the previous times God spoke through the prophets, but in these last days has spoken to us by his Son. So it starts right off trying to communicate the essential truths of who Jesus Christ is to a group of people, some of which who had, you know, had a profession of faith in Jesus, but who were surely under pressure by their culture to back up and back off this whole Jesus thing. Does that sound familiar to anybody? And so why would this be? Well, commentator William McDonald says it this way in his commentary. He says, in a general way, Hebrews deals with the tremendous struggle involved in leaving one religious system for another. There is the violent wrenching of old ties, the stresses and tensions of alienation, and the formidable pressures exerted on the renegade to return to the old ways. But in this epistle, the problem was not, he says, but was not just a question of leaving an old system for a new one of equal value. Rather, it was the matter of leaving Judaism for Christ. And as the writer shows, this involved leaving shadows for substance, ritual for reality, the prior for the ultimate, the temporary for the permanent, in short, the good for the best. The problem also involved, listen, and this is very relevant right now, leaving the popular for the unpopular. The majority for the minority, and the oppressors for the oppressed. And this precipitated, he says, some many problems. And so the author right away begins to try to shore up and encourage the faith of those who had put their faith in Jesus, perhaps even those who were struggling with going back to the old way. Now, just to make sure I'm in the right room, do we face similar pressures today to back up and back off? Perhaps there's someone in the room today. That was five of y'all, thank you. Perhaps there's somebody in the room today who feels that pressure, knowing what the Bible says and what the Bible requires, but all of your friend circle and all of your friend set and all of your coworkers and everybody else thinks this is ridiculous. What are you doing? Why are you giving so much of yourself to this? I mean, you can have a little Jesus and have a little of this too. The phrase in the old church, we used to say, it don't. We all came up in the same church. It don't take all that, apparently, but apparently it does. So is this relevant for us today, this idea of shoring up our faith so that we can persevere? Absolutely. Although our pressures and temptations may be a bit different, we nevertheless face them. The course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, is well encapsulated by the prophet Isaiah, who said this. Read, sir.
Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe unto them that are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight.
I mean, Isaiah is calling us out right now. That's Isaiah chapter 5, verses 20 through 21 in the Old Testament. But based on what we see around us, our world is just as backwards as the world Isaiah was prophesying about. Are y'all with me so far? Okay, and now it's Resurrection Sunday and we look cute, but can I go ahead on and tell you what I came to tell you today? All right, so don't let the colors fool you today. As Deacon said, we are in a battle. And don't get me wrong, I want you to have a beautiful Resurrection Day, and I want you to think about the risen Savior and the risen Lamb, but he's also the risen King. And there's controversy right now about the kingship of Jesus, but let me just make sure you know where you are. Christ is King. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. And he's not just king over you. He's not just king over your home. He's not just king over the church. He's king over everything. Is he king over the government too? He most certainly is. Government officials are ministers unto the Lord, and they will answer for their stewardship. Isaiah said, woe unto them that call good evil and evil good. Beloved, that's kind of where we are. This world's completely backwards. Take anything holy and right and good as God defines holy and right and good, and you will find vocal and passionate people advocating for the opposite, literally calling good evil and evil good. That's the world. And so as I'm not trying to bring you down. I want to talk to you a little bit about the urgency of this whole idea of making sure that your hearts are soft. Because if you're not careful, if your hearts are hard, you could find yourself calling good evil and evil good. Today, we live in a world where biblical sexuality, for just to take one example, is flipped on its head. And we find the widespread celebration of the all things LGBTQ. Today, in fact, is Transgender Day of Visibility, as decreed by our president. Is it always on May 31st? Yeah. But you didn't have to put out a decree, bro. It's Resurrection Sunday, and you know that. Y'all are awfully quiet. That's okay. The very design of men and women versus hyper-patriarchy and feminism, the biblical marriage, which is so wonderful, versus the push to overthrow the godly household, protecting children versus aborting them, killing them, ripping them out of the womb, propriety and shamefacedness versus lasciviousness and haughtiness. Beloved, the world is completely backwards. All the stuff that should make us ashamed, we're celebrating. And the things that we ought to be celebrating, we're ashamed of. And so because of the nature of the world, because of the flesh, because of the devil and the constant fight thereof, there is a cost to following Jesus Christ for all who believe. And he said that there would be much. And so I want to give you this up front, because as we call you to a higher place in the Lord and more consistent faithfulness to the Lord, and to do that today, I'm not trying to tell you that it's going to be a bed of roses. We are in a battle. Jesus said there would be a cost. Luke 9 says this, verse 23, read, Deke.
And he said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it.
Mm-hmm.
But whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. For what is a man advantage if he gain the whole world and lose himself or be cast away?
And whosoever shall be ashamed of me and my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come in his own glory and in his Father's and of the holy angels. He says in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 34, think not that I've come to send peace on earth. And y'all have heard this already today. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a man's foes shall be they of his own household. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. So as we look at having soft hearts, that also means that our hearts must be soft to whatever the Lord sends our way for his own glory. In other words, I don't want to paint the picture too rosy for you this morning, as particularly we live in a time where the culture is not rosy. And true biblical Christianity and holding fast to the Lord and lovingly but boldly declaring that he is the way, the truth, and the life, that's not a rosy picture. In fact, following Jesus like he wants us to follow him could create for you more enemies than friends in some sectors and in some quarters. And are you willing to do that? And is that a place where sometimes our heart gets a little gets a little hard because we don't want to deal with the pressure? We would rather, you know, be able to do it the world's way and just back up and just ease off and just go along to get along. Am I talking to anybody so far? Beloved, our King is worthy of such. This is the day where we celebrate just how worthy he is. He's worthy of this kind of devotion. He's worthy of this kind of sacrifice. In Matthew chapter 1, we find out why he's so worthy. Verse 20 says, but while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost, and he shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. Why should you call his name Jesus? Based on the meaning of Jesus, we find out, for he shall save his people from their sins. And if Christ is still in the grave, we are still in our sins. But he proved everything he ever said and everything he ever did because he got up from the grave. Therefore, he is, in fact, the risen King and Lord, ascended to the right hand of the Father. And for all of us who put our trust and faith in his finished work, we are saved from the penalty of all of our transgressions. Glory to God. And so when that God says, pick up a cross and follow me, when that God says, soften up your heart a little bit, son, and let me do a work in you, when that God says, follow me to the ends of the earth, when that God says, we simply do what he says. Unless our hearts are hard, unless we can't hear very good. And I have to wonder in an age where the church has never had this much money, never had this much property, never had this many buildings, never had this many expositors, all expositing on all these different networks, on Twitter and on Instagram and X and all the podcasting streams. There's a lot of word being preached. What's going on? Why are we looking worldlier? What happened? Did we really hear? Are we really hearing? Our King is worthy of such sacrifice. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached on unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. It's the gospel. Can we hear it? And are we hearing it? And if we have heard it, are we willing to press in Jesus to a place of sanctification where it means that sometimes the war comes to our doorstep? In our text today, the author lays out a chilling and very applicable exhortation and warning, not only to his immediate hearers, but also through them to us. And here's the outline. Essentially, he says, listen, hear. Listen right now, like today. Like, don't wait. We'll talk about why that is. Tomorrow's not promised, essentially. Don't have a hard heart. Is your heart hard? Don't be a wilderness hearer. Don't grieve the Lord as the people of God did in the Old Testament. Hear his voice, know his ways, so that you can enter into his rest. It's a very Old Testament sounding, very prophet sounding exhortation today. So let's work through it. Look at verse number 7. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost says today, if there's that if again, we talked about if last week, Hebrews is wonderful for messing with our theology. So if ye will hear his voice. Remember we said that when there's a wherefore, we have a therefore. In other words, the author is connecting the verses previous. He's saying, because of what I just said, some of the things that I've just said, and then we have our proposition or our statement. These exhortations and warnings are connected to the exhortations and the truths that came before them. And what came before them? Well, in summary, again, from chapter 1, in these last days, God has spoken to us by his Son, Jesus Christ, who, being the brightness of his glory in the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, hallelujah, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. So he starts with this statement of the divinity and the deity, the power of Jesus Christ. But he didn't stop there. He goes on to say that even as that Christ is greater than angels throughout the rest of Hebrews chapter 1 and chapter 2. He tells us a little bit about the salvation of Christ, that we ought to heed that and heed the words of the apostles themselves in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. And then although mankind is not worthy, Christ's salvation was provided by his sufferings. And so there's this understanding of the humanity of Jesus, the incarnation of Jesus. Christ is greater than Abraham. And so for the Hebrew hearer, he makes sure in verse 16 of chapter 2 that he connects Abraham. He understands the love for the Old Testament rituals and sacrifices. And so in chapter 2, verses 17 through 18, Christ is called our merciful and faithful high priest, who is able to succor in King James or help us when we are tempted. And anybody still glad about that? Okay, that was a couple weeks ago. We went through that. But then he's not done. He says, remember, even Moses, who is so venerated and means so much to the Hebrew hearer, that as Moses was the son over his house, Jesus is the owner of the house. Okay, he's the son over his own house. And so in Hebrews, there's this constant theme of the lesser gives way to the greater, of the type giving way to the anti-type. And that's what's going on in these verses. Hey, guys, I know that you grew up in synagogue, and I know that you know about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and I know that you understand Moses, but they all spoke of him. Indeed, they all trusted in him. The one who they were waiting for has come. His name is Jesus, and he is greater than all. And he'll go on to say in this epistle much about Jesus being greater than the temple and greater and greater and greater. And we need these same exhortations, because we may be tempted to go back to an old life or to go back to an old way or to go back to something that meant a lot to us in the past and miss the fact that the one that was prophesied has come and that there is salvation in none other. Indeed, there is no other name under heaven given under heaven whereby men must be saved in the name of Jesus Christ. And so the lesser gives way to the greater. The old is superseded by the new. The types and shadows find their ultimate fulfillment in Jesus Christ. And the author reminds us that his words aren't those of just any man, but he says, as the Holy Ghost saith. And so, yes, he is, in fact, quoting an Old Testament verse here. But it's a wonderful reminder in a day where we're tempted to back off the inspiration and the infallibility of Scripture and indeed the sufficiency of Scripture. It reminds us again that the words that we're reading just don't come from men. They come from God. I mean, I'm still in verse 7, just looking at things. Wherefore gives us the therefore. All these things are adding up for us. Christ is this, and Christ is that, and Christ is this, and Christ is that. Therefore, or wherefore, as the Holy Ghost says, when you hear, in other words, there's nobody else coming. Moses can't save you, and Abraham can't save you. And there's no human priesthood that can do this for you. And so that's constantly what's happening in Hebrews, to the point here where he says, as the Holy Ghost saith. Just a quick reminder for you, the words of God that you hold in the Holy Bible come from God. Read, sir.
All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works.
Amen. I love this from Peter. Peter says it this way in 2 Peter 1, verse 19, sir.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star rise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost.
I tell you what, as much as I love good preaching, There's no preaching that compares to what God has written in his own word. Indeed, the good preacher just says what God says. I mean, we may say it different ways, but we're saying what God says. And what a terrible situation. And listen to me now. What a complete and utter horror to have a situation in your life, in your heart, where your heart is hard to the word of God. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith, today, if ye will hear his voice, because of who Jesus is, the brightness and the expression and the creator and the sustainer, because of who Jesus is, became a man, took on a human nature for our sakes at the incarnation, born of a virgin, to do for us what we could not do. Because he is greater than the angels. Because he is greater than Abraham or Isaac or Jacob. Because he is greater than Moses. Because, as the Holy Ghost saith, these things come from the word of God. Today. Now, yeah, the author is quoting the psalmist, quoting Psalms 95, verses 7 through 11, for the Bible says, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if ye will hear his voice, harden not your heart as in the provocation and as in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my work. 40 years long, he says, was I grieved with this generation and said, it is a people that do err in their heart. They have not known my ways, unto whom I swear in my wrath that they should not enter into my rest. There's a few things going on here. First of all, I want you to get the wherefore. Then I want you to get the idea and be reminded the Holy Spirit is the author of Scripture. And then he says today, he quotes the psalmist, and he puts this exhortation out to a people that there were surely a struggling group of the original recipients of this epistle, maybe dabbling back and forth with, we can mix in a little, I don't know, this, I go too hard on this Jesus thing. I could lose my family. I could lose my job. I could lose my reputation. And so he pulls out everything. He's both barrels are coming at you here on stay firm. Hold on to Jesus. Indeed, today, if you're hearing, remember what happened in the Old Testament when God spoke so clearly and they didn't listen. And so the writer's imploring the hearer to embrace what we're called for a moment, the urgency of today. Y'all okay so far? The urgency of today. By show of hands, how many of you are absolutely 100% sure that you'll live till tomorrow? Anybody sure you'll make it to tonight? What do you really have then? You have now. Unless the Lord decrees a few, little more time. Oh, he gave you a little more. Oh, he gave you a little more. But you have now. Today is always urgent. Listen, because today is all you have. This moment right now where your chest is rising and falling is what you have. That makes it extraordinarily urgent. Now, you could say to yourself, oh, I may live tomorrow and the odds are likely that I will. Yeah, sure. But we live in a day where it's not just the more senior people, the more aged people that are passing away. We live in a day where teenagers are passing away too. Okay? And so the author is imploring the hearer to embrace a couple things. Number one, As they think about today, embrace the urgency of today. Why? Because number one, God should be obeyed when he speaks. Who are we to delay our obedience? Is there ever a time where the creature gets to say to the creator, hold up, and be righteous in the saying? When do you obey your parents, children? When they tell you something. When do you, y'all are quiet. When do you obey God? When God tells you something. And so if, that's a big word, conjunction, junction, right? That's a big one. We talked about it a little bit last week. We don't like the word if a lot of times because the onus is back on us and we kind of don't like that. But if we're hearing, then God is to be obeyed. Number two, because tomorrow is promised to no man. Principally from Proverbs 27 and 1, James chapter 4, verses 13 through 15 also kind of allude to this truth that God doesn't owe you tomorrow. So today is always urgent. The stuff that matters ought to happen today because you're not promised tomorrow. So if you're waiting to tell your husband how much you love him, why wait? All you have is today. If you're waiting to tell your wife just what she means to you, why are you, what are you waiting on? Say it now. If you're waiting to worship or recommit to the things of God, well, I'll do it when my life. So many of us have fallen for that. I'll do this if, and the if never materializes, and we end up in the same spot we were before. So the writer implores the hearer to embrace the urgency of today, because God should be obeyed when he speaks, because tomorrow is promised to no man, and because to disobey today, listen, demonstrates a hard heart. In context, what else do you call it when God speaks? You understand, I understand, and I still delay. Now, that's an uncomfortable thing to think about, that there are areas of hard-heartedness in us. But again, this text, just it just lays it out so beautifully, and there's really no way around it. Well, show of hands, how many of you have known to be stubborn a time or two? You're not going to hell. I'm just asking a question. I know I can be extraordinarily stubborn at times when I'm locked in. But the Lord is saying that's symptomatic of a hard heart, because if you hear, did you hear? Yeah, you understand? Yeah, you're gonna do? No. Was that God's issue or your issue? What is that? Where does that come from? And today, what is God saying? Well, he's giving us the word of God, so he's saying a lot. But if we had to boil it down to a primary message, it would be the gospel, right? God commands men everywhere to repent, to turn away from sin, and to turn to the only one who can save them. Scripture says this in Acts 17 and 30. And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. Did you know that repentance is a command of God? Can you hear his voice saying repent? Right? Romans 2:4 says, oh, despisest thou the riches of his goodness and the forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. It's a wonderful thing when the Lord pricks your heart, my heart, and I get on my hands and knees and go, Lord, what an idiot I am. I'm so sorry. That's a wonderful work of grace. God commands us to repent. He commands men everywhere to repent. Repent of what? What are you trying to say to me, preacher? Well, repent of sin. Now, this is not a word we use much in the contemporary kind of church environments, but and to our shame, quite frankly, because how is the gospel good news if we don't explain the bad news? Romans 3:23, sir.
For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
One more, Romans 5 and 12, sir.
Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
Everybody has sinned. We're all sinners. What is sin? Well, sin is transgression of the law, according to 1 John 3:4. Whosoever committed sin transgresses also the law, for sin is transgression of the law. So when God says do and we don't do, and when God says don't do and we do, that's sin. And there's a price for that. Romans 6:23, sir.
For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
God is so holy and so righteous, and so pure, and so altogether other, that he absolutely detests wickedness and sin. He hates it. It causes his holy nature to recoil, and so it must be punished. Cannot abide it. That's the bad news. It started from the Garden of Eden, and we're still impacted and infected with the sin disease today. Y'all okay? Right? Here's the good news. God is so loving and so kind and so merciful that he sent one to do for us what we couldn't do for ourselves. To be born perfect, which we are not. To live perfect, which we never have been. To indeed the perfect life in our place. And then to bear our guilt and our shame and our punishment on the cross. To suffer and bleed and die for our sins, that we might be cleansed from sin. The wrath of the Father poured out upon the Son, and the righteous life of the Son laid to our account by grace and through faith. So sin is the problem. Christ is the solution. And of course, through him, the Great Commission tells us to teach all things whatsoever he's commanded. And so God continues to speak and talk to us through his word about what he wants for us and how he wants us to live. But our hearts, if our hearts are hard to the first part, our hearts are definitely going to be hard to the second part. If we can't receive that Jesus died for our sins or even admit that we're a sinner, then all the other stuff's going to seem ridiculous. Oh, wives, submit to your husbands. Husbands, we can't hear any of that stuff. Here's how you raise your children. Here's how you handle your money. Here's what I want in my worship. So God commands then that we turn to Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sin. Jesus said it this way: the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. In Acts 2, we read this in verse 36. Deacon, help me out.
Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God have made that same Jesus, whom he crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now, when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Romans 10:9. Through 11 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart, as in a time where people were stubborn, the day of provocation and temptation in the wilderness. But today, if you can hear that, if your heart is soft enough to understand that before a holy God, your knee will bow when your tongue will confess. If your heart is soft enough, if humble enough to bow, and you know, in our very arrogant culture, this is hard without God's help, without God's intervention. But has your heart been softened? Is your heart soft enough to hear that message and then the rest of what scripture teaches? I've been saying for years that if we can learn to fear God again, things would change overnight. You get about 50 million Christians fearing God. Not after prosperity, not trying to get a new house, not naming and claiming their BMW. Not walking around, you know, bragging about how I'm the kid's kid and I'm old, this, that. But the other thing, if we went the other way, we were doing that for the last 60 years, 50 years, how's that working out for us? It's made us arrogant on the one side and unable to stand on the other. But if we had any sense of perseverance, right, any sense of the fear of the Lord, where the Lord speaks and our hearts are so tender, we go, well, you know, I'll admit, Lord, that my flesh don't like that at all, and I might lose some friends over that one, and everybody's going to think I'm absolutely crazy. But blessed be your name. Glory be your name. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. A group like that changes the world, right? A group like that begins to minister and preach the gospel. Their lights begin to shine really, really brightly. And that's who we want to be. That's what we want to be. And so God is speaking. He's talking. The gospel is being heralded by men and women everywhere. And he's saying, teach them everything that I've told you to teach them. That's going on right now. This same Jesus is both Lord and Christ, suffered for our sins and is risen from the dead. And we're just saying he's worthy of all of that. He's worthy of that bowing. He's worthy of that soft heart. He's worthy of all of that. Again, from 1 Corinthians, since we were there earlier today, listen to this. Moreover, brethren, I declared unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which ye have also received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye believed in vain. For I delivered unto you, first of all, which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures, and that he was buried according to the scriptures, and that he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. Hallelujah. This is the message that's urgent. And everything God says is urgent to me, but this is the primary message. And it must be embraced today, because today is all you have. And because the judgment awaits all men. And oh, by the way, again, that's how we ought to embrace all of Scripture. Today, because today is all we have. Today I should be obedient because God's worthy of such. He died for my sins. The Lord rose again for on the third day, ascended to the right hand of the Father. Who am I? Who am I as the creature who's been saved by grace to harden my heart? Now, no one likes to think they have a hard heart, but every time you say no to God, what is that? I mean, call it what you want to. Put a nice little name on it, but it's kind of what it is, right? Yeah. Parents, wave at me, parents. You ever see your children with a hard heart? Clean your room. What's that? It's a frowny face. Where'd that frowny face come from? A hard heart. You ever see them fight each other? Stop hitting your brother. Where'd that come from? It's just rebellion in us. It's another word for hard heart. And the Lord is saying here today, don't be hard-hearted. Are your hearts soft? All you have is right now. You're counting costs about what you're going to lose. Have you forgotten who saved you? The next command in verse 8, harden not your hearts, is where we've kind of been. And this is important because of mankind's propensity, including God's people, sadly, myself very much at the top of that list, to do just that. Verse 8 again, harden not your hearts as in the provocation in the day of temptation in the wilderness. Verse 9 says, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. I said that we have a propensity to have a hard heart. Propensity may not be the best word. Propensity means tendency, inclination, but I might be underselling it a little bit. Scripture is absolutely filled with examples of God's people refusing to obey him. Filled. It's just really, when you read it and you think to yourself, I would have never done that. Like if I'm at the foot of Sinai and I just saw plagues rain down on Egypt, there's no way I'm giving Aaron some gold to make a golden calf. There's no way I'm doing that. We read, you know, kind of where we are now into it, but you don't know. Because look at the stuff you've done since you've been saved. Since I've been saved. Right? This is in us is my point, and that makes this relevant, these verses relevant for everyone. The provocation, the day of temptation, to me is a summary statement of many things that happened. I mean, because there were a couple of different instances that could kind of, you know, this could be describing. It points to the consistent unfaithfulness of Israel in the wilderness with Moses. Again, from McDonald, it was a dreary record of complaint. Lust, idolatry, unbelief, and rebellion. At Rephidim, for instance, they complained because of lack of water and doubted God's presence in their midst. In the wilderness of Paran, when the unbelieving spies returned with an evil report of discouragement and doubt, the people decided that they should go back to Egypt, the land of their slavery. Isn't it amazing how sometimes we want to turn and go back to the place where God delivered us from? And we could go on and on, from the idolatry at Sinai, which we quickly mentioned, to the rebellion of Korah and his company in Numbers 16. The consequences of this kind of provocation, this kind of the days of temptation where God's people had a choice and chose wrong, the consequences of such were often, you know, often resulted in severe judgment from God. I mean, you can't almost read of any of these instances and there wasn't a plague that broke out because of the people's rebellion. And there weren't deaths, like thousands upon thousands of deaths. And so the consequences of this is evident. And so the author here in the New Testament pleads with these folks who surely knew these stories, don't do that. Like you read that and you say, I would never do that. Well, hey, Christ has come, the one Abraham was waiting for, the one Moses is waiting for. Hey, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that. Don't have a hard heart like they did and be deceived and thinking your heart is soft. And beloved, I'll tell you, there's a lot of hard-heartedness. There just is. We read Old Testament words that God used to describe this heart, like stiff-necked, and we kind of chuckle. Because we know that that's an agricultural, we picture a farmer with a donkey, and he's trying to till, and he's trying to move the neck from side to side, and the donkey's like, mm-mm, and those neck muscles are so strong, and there's nothing, and we kind of, stiff neck, wow. But anyone willing to admit to being stiff necked a time or two in life? Exodus 32:9 says, and the Lord said unto Moses, I've seen this people, and behold, it is a stiff necked people. Deuteronomy 10, verse 16 says, circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart and be no more stiff-necked. Who's he talking to? His own people. The command in our text is don't do that. It's just that simple. Harden not your hearts. Yes, it takes an act of God to ultimately cause your heart to be soft. But in a way that I don't fully understand, there is the text, he's talking to people. He's talking to an individual. He's talking to the hearer. And so there's some play that we have in it when we decide to. And can any of you remember, with your saved self, a time where the word of God came forward? Today, it came forward and you went. And you anchored down in who you are and what you are and what you believe. And it's not an issue of confusion. You know what it said. That's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about confused hearts today. We're talking about hard hearts. I've been saying for years, and there are good men that are smarter than me that disagree with me on this, and that's okay because I could be totally wrong. But I've been saying that the bulk of America, particularly boomers, Gen Xers, and millennials, aren't gospel ignorant. They're gospel hardened. In other words, if you ask them, did you know the Christian gospel? Yeah, Jesus came and he died for my sins. And you know, they'll give you a snapshot. Now, do they understand it fully? You know, not necessarily, but they're not like, no, I never heard of this guy. Now, other parts of the world, maybe some Gen Zers, you know, I don't know what you're talking about. But most of us, you know, Gen X, the greatest generation, go Gen X. The bridge generation. It's always boomers and millennials. Gen Xers are just somewhere breakdancing. but I've been saying for years, I think it's a hardening issue because they could give you a pretty, you know, not everybody, but a good chunk of them could, yeah, he died for my sins, and he came, and yeah. And there are parts of the world where people go, I've never heard of Jesus. This is a heartening issue. Again, from the point earlier, how many churches do we have in America? 300,000, 400,000? More money? More people expositing? More. Where's the sanctification of the culture? Now, I'll hold out that this could be a judgment issue. Like, it could be God doing a thing. I'll give you that. But you would think, given who we are, that there will be more of us, and there would be more recoil and more gospel preaching and more bold stands from tyrannical governments all the way to a bold stand against my own propensity to do evil. The command in the text is don't be this way. Say that with me. Don't be this way. Again, can you think of a worse condition than having a heart unreceptive to God's words? And it wasn't like he wasn't speaking clearly through Moses, thundering down from the mountain. They were seeing miracles. It wasn't an issue of miracles. Man, if there were just more miracles, they had miracles. Water from rocks, people being swallowed up, going down into the earth, fire falling from heaven, manna every morning, Red Sea. I mean, they saw it all. They still were stiff-necked. So maybe the question is, okay, let's figure this out the time we have remaining, this whole issue of the heart, and what is a heart? Well, Vodi Bakum said a heart is a muscle in your chest that pumps blood, right? So it's just a muscle. So when the Bible uses the word heart, there's something else going on here. Often from the Hebrew word labab in the Old Testament, the Greek word cardi in the New Testament, Vine's dictionary says the word heart came to stand for man's entire mental and moral activity. Both the rational and emotional elements. In other words, the heart is used figuratively for the hidden springs of the personal life. The Bible describes human depravity as in the heart because sin is a principle which has its seat in the center of man's inward life and then defiles the whole circuit of his action. The Webster 1825 dictionary gives a 15-part definition for heart, but it includes the seat of affections and passions, the seat of understanding, the seat of the will. The heart, as used in Scripture, points to the seat of man's emotions, his feelings, his thoughts, or his soul. The heart is the core of our being. It is synonymous often with the inner man. And so we're not talking about the muscle in the chest that pumps blood. It's talking about the soulish realm. And sometimes in the soulless realm where we think and feel and decide, right, that place gets hard. And we decide we have a better plan than God. But on this Resurrection Sunday, be reminded, you don't have a better plan than God. What is a hardened heart then? So now that we've established a little bit of what a heart is, well, here's our definition of it, just our best take at it. A hard heart is a heart that will not hear and obey in that moment. Just will not hear and obey. It is not necessarily a confused heart. That's different. It understands, but it is more committed to its own will than God's. And this is what Hebrews does to us on several occasions. It puts us, it just shines this really kind of mirror back at us, and all we can do, you know, is just sit and look at ourselves for a moment. And so in that respect, Hebrews can be challenging. But this is what's being said. In short, it is a person to whom God has spoken and lightly has greatly blessed, but who still would not submit to him. And the author is going, hey, remember when your fathers did this? Remember when this happened in the time of Moses and Aaron? Remember Korah and Miriam? Remember Peor in that mess instigated by Balaam? Remember. Hey, remember? Yeah, okay, don't do that. Don't do that. Today, change that. Don't back up. Embrace him today. They fail to in many instances. Don't you fail to. Embrace him today. And it is a devastatingly sad state given the love and mercy of God. How many of you would agree that God has richly blessed you? You're here today under the mercy and the grace of God, right? Amen? Okay. Nehemiah, I don't read this whole thing, but I was going to initially, but I'm looking at the clock. Nehemiah lays this out so beautifully in Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 7. He just, starting in verse 7 down through verse 17, he just lists all these things that God has done for his people. And at the end of, just listing blessing after blessing after blessing, he says, but our fathers dealt proudly and hardened their necks and hearkened not to thy commandments and refused to obey. And it's such a sad thing. So I'll just put the question to you today on this Resurrection Sunday, a time where things can, you know, spring, the Lord's risen, and we can reset and refocus on so many things, and so many people love this season for that reason. Is there any place of hardness in you? Are there things that God has spoken to you by his word, and you know them to be true, but for whatever reason, you've built up some walls around those precepts, those patterns? Okay. What causes this to happen? Well, beloved, if I'm going to be honest with you, a love of sin does, particularly a prideful love for ease and good times. In Matthew chapter 13, we read in verse 19, when anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth the way of that which was sown in his heart. This is he who received the seed by the wayside. But he that received the seed into stony places, i.e. a harder heart, the same is he that heareth the word and anon with joy receiveth it. So he got it. He understood it, but have no root in himself, endureth for a little while. For when tribulation or persecution ariseth because of the word, by and by he is offended. It's this desire to be accepted by the world, this desire to be loved by the enemies of God, a desire for what the flesh wants, which oftentimes sets you at ease or communicates some artificial place of neutrality with the world. And the more this happens, the harder your heart gets. The longer this goes on, the harder one's heart becomes. Jesus said, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. The Apostle Paul said, he called it past feeling or becoming desensitized in Ephesians 4:19. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, the conscience is said to be seared with a hot iron as this goes on. It becomes harder and harder and harder. And this is why we sometimes say some of the things that we say so that we don't fall for the devices of the enemy, and that our hearts become soft to those things that it should be hard to, and hard to those things it should be soft to. Dangerously, and I am going to read this one because this is America right now. Dangerously, after prolonged disobedience, God himself can give one over to increased hardness, or what the Bible calls a reprobate mind. Read, sir, Romans 1.
professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like unto corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to disown their bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up.
Gave them up.
Unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of error which is meet.
And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. And he goes on to list so many of the things. This is a dangerous place to be. To hear the word, to understand the word, to reject the word, and stay in a place of rejection. And it gets harder and harder and harder. And in the culture, God's word goes out. You know, God is seen and known through the proclamation of the gospel and the preaching of the church. But Romans 1 also tells us there's no excuse, because you can look in creation and also see God, the God of the Bible. And says, okay, you don't want to respond. Well, eventually there's judgment falls. I'll give you over. I'll turn you over. I'll harden you. As I harden Pharaoh, I'll harden you too. This is what you want. This is what you get. And those are frightening. That's a frightening proposition. And the author is going, let's stay away from all of that. Some of you have seen it. You've seen Christians who you grew up with, went to the same church, went to the same Bible studies, blah, blah, blah. Problems happen. They go off script, go literally off script. You try to, you know, you're trying to reel back in, but they're harder in it and harder in it and harder in it. And then you lose track and they divorce or blah, blah, blah. And you look up and you hear about, you see them on Facebook, you know, 5 years later, and they're at the beach with no clothes on, or they're cursing and drinking fifths of vodka. And you go, what in the world? Just, and they got harder and harder and harder and harder and harder. Oh, thank God for the mercy of Jesus Christ. Because that's who we could be, but for his grace. So what do we do here, Bishop? I mean, yeah, we all have areas. Yeah, well, let's try to work that out in the time we have remaining. How might one be healed of a hard heart? And how will you know you got some measure of healing going on? Well, first of all, know that even though man has some culpability in the hardening, it really does require God for it to get solved. It requires an act of God, a new heart of flesh rather than stone. Ezekiel 36 says it this way, sir.
A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them.
This wonderful transformation that Ezekiel's talking about, a new spirit, a new heart, a new desire for the word, begins when you say yes to Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things are become new. Glory to God. So when we say yes to Jesus, when we repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, there ought to be this process that starts where our affections begin to change. Now, everyone's rate of sanctification is a little different. We're not, you know, into legalism, but there should be something different about you if you're walking with Jesus. Amen, right? And so you'll know that something's changed, because as you are sanctified or continually purified by the Holy Spirit, your affections will change and your receptivity to God's word will increase. When the preaching is coming, and the word, the preacher's just saying what the Bible says, and your nose is wrinkling up, that's a problem. Because that's not the preacher, and that's not the word. That's something going on in you. But if you're sitting there going, oh my goodness, I need to fix that. Thank you, Lord. Bless your name. Even if you're getting cut, and you go, thank you, Lord, for cutting me today. Because you just read me all up and down and one side or the other, and thank you, Jesus. I mean, you're glad to be disciplined of the Lord, because you know the Lord loves those whom he chastises. That is an indicator that something is different. So let me make it plain. If there's no love for God, if there's no, except for a verbal, kind of a verbal statements, if there's no love for the things of God, no love for prayer, no desire for word, no desire for holiness, no desire to come to church, no desire, no desire, no desire, then you're right to make your calling and election sure. Something's off. Something's wrong. Did something happen? Was there some traumatic event? What happened to get your heart this hard? And are you willing today to back up, even if you're a Christian, and go, Lord, somewhere along the line, my heart got hard. Maybe it was this, maybe it was that. But I don't want to live like this. I want to live the way you've commanded me to live. I don't want to live in rebellion as they did. You've given me today. I want to please you today. And so in verse 10, wherefore I was grieved with that generation and said, they always err in their heart. And they've not known my ways. And these words are just so sad. The psalmist writes in Psalm 78 and verse 40, how oft did they provoke him in the wilderness and grieve him in the desert? Here's one thing we don't talk about because I guess we think that grace somehow undoes this. We don't talk about the fact that we grieve God. And when I think about his resurrection, when I think about everything that preceded all the way back to the incarnation, indeed, when I think about the fact that the Lord had me in mind from the foundations of the world. Right, any married folk in the building, maybe I'll try to explain it this way. I'm married, coming up on 32 years with my beautiful wife, Donna. And I put a lot of time in trying to love her properly and caring for her and protecting her. But one of my motivations is on the love side. The other part of my motivation is on the not wanting to disappoint her side. I've always had in my heart a fear of disappointing her, of grieving her, of having her be hurt by something I did. From the day we married to the day, I like to see that big smile with all the extra teeth. I can't bear the thought of her hurt because of something I did. How much more should we feel like that with God? We don't often think about this. But it says here he was grieved. Now, yeah, this word probably means it's closer to anger, right? Most versions were probably translated anger. I don't want to anger him either. He was displeased with them because they provoked him. God's displeasure and anger may not be easy to think about, nor does it make for popular preaching, but beloved, it exists. Romans 1:18 says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. God was angry. Wrath is revealed. The Bible says in Psalm 7 and verse 11, God judges the righteous, and God, here's everyone's popular verse, God is angry with the wicked every day. That's in your Bible. And so he says in verse 11, so I swear in my wrath, they should not enter into my rest. These last two verses are just so sad. The rest referred to in the quoted Psalm was a physical rest, most likely, the promised land of Canaan. But here in Hebrews, and speaking to those of us in Jesus, the antitypical rest is not just physical. It's spiritual. It's eternal life in Jesus Christ. It begins at our salvation and will be fully consummated at the return of Christ. The rest that God's referring to for us might be physical, might be times of blessing on the earth, but it's more than that because Jesus is more than that. It's about living with him in all eternity. And the author's saying, they didn't get the Canaan rest because the generation that rebelled had to die in the wilderness. And how sad that was. But again, a theme of Hebrews, the lesser fulfilled by the greater. Are y'all really going back up? And we'll have to start dealing with what apostasy is next week because Hebrews forces us to. But is your calling and election, you made a confession of faith. Are you really going back? Because they didn't enter the rest because they were hard-hearted. Are you sure you're going to enter the rest? Is your faith genuine? Did you really trust in Jesus? Will you enter God's rest? Are you ready for the sky to crack and the trump to sound? Are you 100% sure that your soul is anchored in the Lord? Hard-heartedness is rampant. We all have it. But is your heart tender to the gospel of Jesus? And is there evidence of fruit in your life of a continual growth in the scriptures because your Savior got up from the grave? Does your life bear witness that you have been saved from sin, death, and hell? We urge you today as we close to flee the hard heart and to Christ, to receive a new heart by repenting and believing in Jesus Christ, and allow the Lord to change you and move you as He will for his own glory. And we urge you in Jesus, do it today, because today is all you have. Let's pray. Father, thank you for being so patient with us, so amazingly kind to us. Thank you that the day of salvation came for so many of us. And because of your activity in our hearts and in our minds and our souls, we heard and we repented and we believed and we're saved. Lord, even for your people, there are places that where you're speaking through your scripture and our hearts, for whatever reason, might be hard. I pray you soften the hearts of your people today so that in whatever level of rest that the obedience to those commands will bring, they would receive the fullness of that blessing in Jesus' name. And then if there may be some here who may not be believers in Jesus or may be wrestling with this whole Jesus thing, maybe the old world's pull or the old religion's pull or all those things, all those pressures coming to bear. We pray, O Lord, that you would prick hearts and minds today, that somehow through our feeble preaching and our best effort at singing and exhorting, that you'd minister to the hearts of those who may not know you and by your grace, save them. Show them their sin, show them their transgression, as painful as that is, and then help them see that there is a way of escape. And that way was born out of a love that we cannot fully understand. A love of the creature or the creator for the creature. A love of the Father to send the Son. A love of the Son to gather us up and to give us eternal life. We urge you, we beg you, repent today and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let today's Resurrection Sunday be the start of something for you. See your sin in the light of God's holiness. Turn from it and to the Savior, for there is salvation in no other. And if we can assist you, help you in any way, talk you through the basics of what it means to walk with Jesus, make sure you have a Bible, baptize you because you want to obey your King who commands you to be baptized, then let us know. If you don't have a church family, I was debating whether to say this morning, but I'll say it. The hour is such that it really, you know, it's really later for playing church. Like you really need to choose a church where when they say they believe the Bible, it's not just words, but there's evidence that they believe the Bible. We need the anchor of God's authority in our lives today. And they do it in love, and they do it with grace, and they do it with laughter, but they do it. So we want to be that. We're not perfect, but we want to be that. But we urge you, believer, don't let another resurrection season go by and you're not a member of a local church and submitted to local elders. Let this be a time where you gather in your family and they teach you about marriage and they teach you about manhood and they teach you about womanhood. They teach you about parenting and they teach you the fundamentals of the faith and systematically teaching you doctrine about the deity of Christ and the Trinity of God and the sanctification of the believer and all these things that we must be, you know, have renewed in our hearts again and again and again. You know, the blessing of Resurrection Sunday is that many people go to church. The tragedy of Resurrection Sunday is that it kind of all goes back to normal next week. Don't let that be your testimony. Repent and believe in Jesus. He's worth giving your life for. He rose from the dead. Glory to God. Let's prepare now for the offering in the Lord's table, and then we'll sing a little bit and be dismissed. I'm going to need a handheld here momentarily, brothers, real quick. Just real fast. Let's go ahead. If you're visiting with us, thank you. We're glad that you came. Hope you have a wonderful Resurrection Sunday. Rest of your day would be so fruitful that you would enjoy family and friends, but that you would also meditate deeply on what you heard today. Thank you, Minister. Appreciate it. Amen. If you're giving today, you can give on your way out the door in the back at those two tables. Most of you are giving using our church app now. That's great. But if you'd like to give another way, you're welcome to do that as well. We thank you for even considering giving to us. Let's pray over the offering, and then we'll do the Lord's table together. Amen. Father, thank you for one more opportunity to praise you, one more opportunity to declare your word. Today is the day. Today is the day. Today is the day where we make some adjustments and changes. Today is the day where that nagging verse that we lock back in. Today is the day where we repent anew. The day is today, Lord, where our joy reignites. Today is today. And we ask that even in our giving, you would be merciful and keep us employed and help us to be generous. We pray that these resources we use for the upbuilding of your kingdom, and that even in our generosity, we do that today as well. All these things, Lord, we need to do today in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Let's prepare now for the Lord's table. The communion elements are in the back if you need them. This is an ordinance for believers. And so if you're visiting with us and you're not quite sure about whether or not you're a believer just yet, please don't feel pressure. Just watch. It's good. And the rest of us, we will observe the Lord's table today. Amen. Well, why'd you say that? Why can't I do it? Well, the apostle commands us he gives us some frightening words in 1 Corinthians 11 that this ordinance is for us. And so it's not meant to make you feel bad, I don't think. It's just more of a warning. And so that's why we do it, for your protection. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23 says, "For I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.'" Beloved, please take the symbol of the Lord's body, this little wafer. It symbolizes his body that was broken for us, that was tortured for us. Think about all that he went through on the cross. Praise God, he got up, but he suffered first. Please break it, and in remembrance of him, eat all of it. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. "After the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, 'This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me.'" Please take the cup. And in remembrance of the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of God and God the Son, poured out for our sin, please take and drink all of it. Thank you, Jesus. "For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup," what? "We do show the Lord's death as he comes." Amen. God is good. Amen. 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 Come on, stand to your feet. And as you're standing, do you love our Savior today? Yes. Come on, can we give him a little bit of praise? Well, we're going to do two things. We're going to sing our closing hymn, Reformation Hymn, and then one of the best pastors that I know, a man who I deeply look up to and learn from, is in the building today. He's taught me so many things, way, way, way smarter than me. His name is Jason Dome, and I'm going to ask, before I say the benediction, I'm going to ask Jason, after we sing, to just pray for us right quick. Jason, are you okay with that, brother? Yep, okay. Praise God. Come on, Reformation Hymn, then Pastor Dome will come, and then we'll go down from this place. Amen. Everybody together. All right. Let's sing, church. We will trust. We will trust. they shift like sand, while his truth forever stands. Come on and sing it. Is Jesus Christ and his fame. Oh, come on. Hallelujah. Through the church. He has freed us. He has freed us. He'll keep us. Second and final verse. We are saved. We are saved by grace alone. No accomplishment on earth can achieve. And we will stand on Christ alone. Nations rage, devils roar, still he reigns. Come on and sing, church. Yes. Through the church. He has freed us. He'll keep us. Glory be, glory be, glory be to God alone. One time around for me. He has freed us. He'll keep us. Anybody believe that? Hallelujah. Glory be to God alone. Glory be, glory be, glory be to God alone. Last time, glory be, glory be, glory be to God alone. Come on, Jason. Come on, Pastor. Can we lift our hands and just thank the Lord for his mercy today?
One of my favorite benedictions in Scripture is the end of Jude. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power both now and forever. God, what a sweet privilege to be among your people, under the shadow of your wing, enjoying your goodness, enjoying your favor because of the cleansing blood of your Son. Thank you for your word, Lord, the perfection of it, how much we need it, how much it changes the way we think about everything in life. Thank you for the preaching
Thank you, Lord.
Of your word.
Yes.
You have helped us to see the urgency of today. Help us to be a people who never want to put off a single thing till tomorrow. Thank you for giving us to each other. Pray that you would help us to be such an encouragement to one another in walking closely with you. Let us be a people
yes.
who walk closely with you. In
yes,
Jesus'
Lord.
Name.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, he read it, so let's say it again. Come on, lift your hands. I don't know if Jason even knew that that's our benediction. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. All the people of God said,
Amen.
Happy resurrection, guys. Love you all. See you soon.